Welcome to Community House. Welcome to this historic moment, as today, Community House plays host to Zambia's incoming 7th Republican President, President-elect, Mr. Hakainde Hichilema. I am your moderator today. My name is Tabo Kawana. I'm the Alliance Media Director, and I am not alone. I'll be assisted by my co-moderator, the Choma Central Member of Parliament, and UPND Party spokesperson, Honorable Cornelius Mwitwa. At this point in time, I would like to invite all of us to remain upstanding as we sing the national anthem. The national anthem, please. Stand and sing, O
Zambia, proud and free, land of wake and joy, unity.
All right, we'll be going back to the residence of the 7th President of the Republic of Zambia, incoming Mr. Hakainde Hichilema, who will be addressing at that particular briefing. So stay with us. We're just trying to make some sound improvements to that particular audio that's coming from there. So don't go away. Stay with us. And there's a lot that is expected, obviously, just like you at home are highly expectant to listen to the president. Let's take you back.
Free men we stand under the flag of our land. Zambia, praise to thee. Oh, one strong and free.
Thank you very much. Although we all need to learn the national anthem. At this point in time, allow me to call upon Pastor Kangwa to come and give us an opening prayer. Pastor Kangwa.
Shall we pray? Our Lord and our God, we thank you for the peace over this land. We thank you, Lord, for answering the people's cry. We thank you, Lord, for this day. Lord, we ask that you would grace our incoming Republican President-elect with wisdom, our Vice President, our Alliance partners, and the leadership of this country. Father, we pray that may the unity and the prosperity of this nation come to pass. In Jesus' name, we bless your name. Amen and amen.
Thank you very much. At this point, allow me to call upon my co-moderator, Honorable Mwitwa, to come and take on the show.
I think we can ask the president, everybody else to take their seat.
To be difficult.
My job this morning is very simple, or it's afternoon. It has been a long, long wait to this place. Some of us have even lost track of time. My job is very simple this morning. A tough and long journey has come to an end, and a more difficult one is beginning today. Therefore, I want to take this opportunity to recognize in our midst the presence of the incoming President of the Republic of Zambia, President-elect Hakainde Hichilema. Flanked by the former running mate, who is now Vice President-elect Madam Mutale Nalumango. We also have in our presence the honor of having the former president of the Republic of Zambia, Dr. Guy Scott. He was the chief advisor in this campaign to the president-elect, President Hakainde Hichilema. We also do have the honor of having all the alliance partner presidents, and I will highlight their names because they are all the same, they are all presidents. But in their midst, there is the Alliance Chairperson, Honorable Charles Milupi. And next on his left is, of course, Mr. Akafumba, the NDC leader. And on his right, we do have Dr. Ernest Mwansa, and next to him is Mr. Semuyemba and Dr. Shimunza. And of course, to the far right is Honorable Felix Mutati. And behind there, of course, is the Secretary General of the MDC, Honorable Mulusa, is not a president. And we also do have in our presence, I think, the presence of Mr. Msoni and Mr. Chikuse. If I haven't recognized anyone of you colleagues present, I apologize. Here we are, a long journey coming to where we are. This is a historic moment that millions of Zambians have been waiting for, as evidenced by the long queues that characterized this particular election and the resounding victory. The expectations of the people are high. The nation is anticipating to hear the voice of the next president of the Republic of Zambia. President Hakainde Hichilema, here is the nation listening. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Just to start by recognizing our colleagues in the leadership of our movement, to recognize our leaders of the movement, the UPND Alliance, I shall repeat that, and I hope we can be orderly for just a few minutes. Get done with the business of now. I was just recognizing the leadership of our movement, the UPND Alliance, all the constituent parties that are represented in the Alliance, of course, respective members, constituent members of those component parties. very important for us to recognize the presence of Dr. Guy Scott, who served as our president at some time. Thank you for being here, Dr. Scott. We need, and I believe we should recognize all of you that are here, but truly to recognize the media, local media that have walked with us through this difficult journey. The international media that have been available when the local media could not open their mouths lest they got arrested. The international media was there. The Global Village media was there. Thank you for that. And all colleagues that are here, colleagues that are following this short address through various platforms, thank you for being with us, joining us in the next few minutes. My fellow citizens, citizens of Zambia, it is with great honor, humility, gratitude that I stand before you today to say change is here. The voters of Zambia, the voters of Zambia, and through them, the people of Zambia have prevailed. I think that's very important, that the voters decided who should lead them for the next 5 years, and not those who count votes. Very important for democracy. Zambia, therefore, has prevailed. This victory does not belong to a church, to Bali. This victory belongs to the men and women of Zambia, especially the youth, especially the youth. This was your election. You started by registering in large numbers under very, very restrictive and difficult conditions. You were in the queues to register as voters. I think the signal was sent that time that the youth of Zambia, who are in the majority, had taken a position for the 2021 elections. I took note of that. We took note of that. I think some people did not take note of that. The queues were long to register as voters. The queues were long to vote for change. And you did vote for change. We thank you for that. Truly, it's befitting to say, this was your election. It was your election, evidenced by the numbers. The numbers that turned out to vote, large numbers. The energy and passion that was exhibited by this young population. This population that owns this country. By all probability, they are likely to live longer than others in this country. So they have a higher stake to what happens to their country. Indeed, you send a clear message, a resounding message that has gone all around the world. You've stated your intentions. We have heard you. We have heard you. Although this message you have tasked onto HH, you have tasked onto the running mate, and soon to be vice president. Not elect, but in situ. In situ, under UPND Alliance, indeed the people of Zambia, those that are card-carrying members of our component parties are definitely fewer than the ordinary citizens that voted for us. Look at the numbers. So it is clear that it's the people of Zambia who have given us such a huge resounding mandate to form government and to deliver on the promise of change. It is in no doubt what the instruction is to all of us that have been just elected into office at such a very, very difficult time. We understand what you've done. We understand what you want us to do. We comprehend that. We are under no illusion. We know what you want. And we want to thank you at this stage for your support. And we pray that we will be worth of your trust. We will be worth of your confidence that you have demonstrated and placed on our shoulders to deliver. To deliver, to answer your cries for change. Fellow citizens, it is indeed a new day in Zambia. It's a new beginning for all of us. Sure. Please take care of them. Let's continue with the business. Please take care of them. With the election behind us, let us come together as Zambians, as a family. And that's what we are. Once again, we have an opportunity to sing the old song, to return to what we knew when some of us were growing up. One Zambia, one nation. One nation. And this to us is not a simple matter. It's not a phraseology. It's not a matter of playing with words. This we should translate in everything we do, in all the things that we work on to truly walk this phraseology of one Zambia, one nation. It is easy to talk. It's easy to say things, but we want to demonstrate that we will walk the talk. And you will see that very soon, starting with the cabinet. The cabinet will represent this country. You will see that, and you will make your own judgment, and will send a signal that that phraseology, we will leave it just a few days from now. Mm-hmm. Start marking the script of what we've been saying in terms of reuniting this country. And I can assure you in advance, we will get a high mark for it, even from critics. To those, thank you, to those who voted for other candidates, because this is a democracy, this is competition, this is not war, this is not extermination of others, this is a competition to serve. And we want to recognize the fact that others voted for other candidates. And we say to all of you who voted for other candidates, we extend our hand, yes, a hand of friendship, mm-hmm, our respect, mm-hmm, for having decided to vote for alternative candidates. Yes. It doesn't hurt us. It just reinforces the importance of democracy, its value, the choices that people must continue to have. And no one should take away a citizen's choices. Choices of leadership, choice on what they want to be in their country. The opportunities must be available for all to make their decisions. And it should hurt nobody. That should not be any cause for jail sentences for people to express their views in terms of who they want to lead them and how they want to live their lives. As long as they do that within the laws, within common decency, that should be promoted. And we want to thank you, such voters, and record our respect for you. Please get to know that. Though today you may be disappointed that your candidates did not win, we wish to embrace you as your brothers, as your servants, because that's what we truly are. Those of us who seek public office must get it and get it straight that we are not masters of the people. We are servants of the people. I think it's very important. On that score, I wish to confirm that I and our team will be, for me, president, and for others, servants for all of our citizens across the 10 provinces of Zambia. It does not matter how you look by color. It won't matter how you look by height, by your features. It won't matter. Under this administration, it will not matter who your mother, who your father is, because you never made that decision as to who will be your mother and your father. It is a decision beyond your control. But you will be an equal citizen of this beloved country called Zambia. Mark our words, get your script and your pencil aside, and keep marking as we serve you in the months, in the years to come. And after 5 years, take your tour and see how we have walked the talk. I think we will pass with flying colors. For those that voted for us, and for those that did not, you will be treated equally. Shall I repeat that? For emphasis. And you know what I mean. When I say that, you know what I mean. For those that voted for us, and those that did not vote for us, you will be treated equally, equitably, fairly. That's important to us. That's important to us. We will run this country without preference for any group over another. Absolutely no preference at all. We will govern without selectivism. We will serve knowing that all citizens to us are identical twins in the way we see you, in the way we serve you. It will not matter what your name is, your surname is, for you to rise in the civil service, to be permanent secretary, to be secretary of cabinet, your surname won't matter. Yes. What will matter? Yes. What will matter? Two things. One, you are a citizen of Zambia. Two, that you are competent for the job at hand. That's it. That's it. Nothing else. And feel safe that no one will retire you in national interest, yet is under the guise of personal interest. Nothing of that sort will happen ever again. Not under our administration. And I send a signal to all my colleagues that will serve in cabinet and in other portfolios, that you're not coming into cabinet to marginalize citizens, to exclude citizens. You are coming into cabinet to be a tool for inclusion, to be a tool for unity, to be a tool for creating opportunities for all our people. Yes. Simple, straight, isn't it? It's as simple as that. That confirms the values of inclusivity, equality, recognizing that we need to promote the concept of unity and diversity. 72 ethnic groups, all of them gifts from God. Sometimes minor variations in the culture, in the upbringing. We will not focus on the differences. We will focus on the things that should unite us as a people. Big difference, isn't it? Yes. Big difference from what we've been seeing over the years. Sometimes colleagues fear to say things the way they see them, because they say things that they don't believe in. We harbor no such fears. We say things because we believe in them. You ever heard? We say things because we believe in them. We're consistent because we believe in certain things, in those things that should better your lives. So there must be no secret around those issues, because then you'll be able to judge our behavior, our performance going forward. Shall I say that now is the time to move forward? Yes. Beyond the partisanship of the election. The election period, to some people, invokes anger. And to some people, they say things that should never be said about another human being. I think you know what I'm talking about. Yes. You understand? People who sang the song of ethnic hatred throughout their campaign, but yet in their hometown, they lost to us, who they demonized. Now is the time. Now is the time to forgive such people. For they did not know what they were doing. Now is the time for us to show them the better side of life and perception of other humans. I guess if they are normal, they will learn a lesson going forward. That divisiveness will get you punished by the voters. And I'm proud of the voters of Zambia across the country. I'm very proud of you voters representing the 18 million plus Zambians. You have said no to ethnic divide. Look at the results. Look at where our votes are coming from. Look at these millions of votes. They've been delivered by all the 10 provinces of Zambia. That is beautiful, isn't it? That is lovely, isn't it? Against an orchestrated hate language, hate messages promoted by those who had the opportunity to rein in on such people, but did not. It only tells you a message that they actually sent them out to say those things against fellow citizens. That should come to an end. UPND Alliance members, you are not about to replace those individuals with yourselves. Then you are no different from those individuals. I hope I'm clear about it. Let us put the past behind us For it is what we do now, in the present, that will define our future. Completely. At this stage, I seek your attention, added attention to more than what you've granted me already. I want to spend a minute or so to talk about violence, lawlessness. Let me be clear. We are categorically clear about this. We are victims of violence. We are victims of demonization, mudslinging. For years, you all know that. We are victims of retribution. We are not about to take public office, replace those that have been very violent against our people, and only to start a new wave of violence. We're not about to be that. Absolutely not. I have heard, I have seen on social media, some people out there damaging property, attacking citizens. I didn't say some citizens. I said citizens. I'm aware that some of those citizens who are being attacked were the violent ones against us. But I say it to you, I put it to you, that if you want to show that you occupy a higher moral ground, even when you know who attacked you before, under this brutal regime which is exiting, if you want to show that you're different from them, do not attack them. Do not damage property, someone's property. In the way we calculate national assets, it includes individual assets. So those are national assets in terms of property. None of you, I repeat, none of you should damage anyone else's property. Even when you know the owner abused you. Because if you do that, you are no different from those people. I want to believe we are different from those people. And that's why Zambians have given us this huge mandate to correct those wrongs. Please, do not cause violence out there. Please do not damage anyone's property, public property, private property. If you damage a shopping center, a shop, because you know the owner, and the owner offended you, you are taking away someone's job. Tomorrow they will not be able to work in that shop. But in our manifesto, we are talking about creating jobs. So you are negating the very reason that Zambians have voted for us. That's not who HH is. Follow my example. Follow our example. Demonized, arrested 15 times. We are not going into office to arrest those who arrested us, because then we are no different from them. Namikupa banavahes. Namilomba. Come out of the streets. Come out of the streets. If you have bad intentions, if you want to harm somebody, if you want to damage someone's property, come out of the streets. I know you may be angry. I know you were tear gassed over the last 7 years. I know you were arrested. I'm one of you, but I'm not bitter. Follow my example. Follow my example. Show magnanimity. You should celebrate. Indeed, it's cause for celebration. New dawn. freedoms, rule of law, anti-corruption, opportunity for education, for all, opportunity for a job, opportunity to do business. I would like to see many young people become businessmen at an age earlier than when I became a business person myself, at 26. I want to see people at 21 becoming business people, and we shall support you. But that's not connected to being violent. We want to see magnanimity. We want to see a new way of treating the violent ones. And I want to assure you, a few days from now, there will be no bus stop where you fear to go to. I can assure you, there's no taxi rank that will be a no-go area for you. You can wear your PF t-shirt, you can wear your any other party t-shirt, including UPND. The bus stops, the markets, public places will be available for you. No one will touch you. No one will take away your rights, freedom of movement, freedom of assembly, because of violence, because of any other vices of that nature. But the UPND and its alliance partners lead by example. Come out of the streets if your intent is to damage somebody. You have heard me. But go out and celebrate. Sing. Hoot your car horns. Greet somebody out there. Go and greet the one who you know, your neighbor, was attacking you. Go and tell them that there's a new dawn. There's peace. There's stability coming. Don't end there. Go and tell them that you too will be looked after by the UPND and its alliance government. Is that not a powerful message? Love conquers hate. Yes. Yes. To our competitors, we thank you for your participation in these elections. We are grateful for your graciousness. A number of the 16, amongst the 16 or so presidential candidates, a greater number of them have formally conceded defeat. They have congratulated us for winning this election, which we have won, which has been delivered to us by the people of Zambia. And this win is for you as well. Believe us, you will see that in the months ahead. You will see that in the months ahead. This acknowledgement of our victory to save, not to be saved by the people, is humbling. And a few minutes ago, this list of gracious competitors in the presidential race have added on another colleague who was slow. I'm sure he had his own reasons. President Edgar Chagwalungu. I want to thank you, sir, for your message, for conceding defeat, and for indicating that you support a smooth transition, I don't want to call it power, of servant leadership. I think it's the barest minimum someone who occupies public office, as you exit, you facilitate the new entrance to continue serving the country and its people where you left it. It's the barest minimum. And I want to assure the people of Zambia in advance, when our time to leave comes, we will graciously leave. We will support the incoming team then. But for you to be an incoming team, you better work hard, because we are going to raise the standards of that office. I encourage you to work harder because this team has not come to celebrate. This team has come to work. To work and to work and more work. That is the value I personally bring to public office. Hard work, diligent work. In my early days in the profession, I knew no working hours. I don't believe in working hours. I believe in the outcomes, the deliverables. You will see this in this administration. And I think you will appreciate it after a few months, a few years from now. And that's why we believe we will earn your confidence going forward within the laws. Third term is not part of our language. It's not part of our language. It should not be part of anyone's language. And Zambians have spoken about it. And you, the lawyers, must deal with those lacunas. No one should seek a third term. Zambians have spoken about this from the Chona Commission in the 70s. Mwanakatwe Commission, Mungomba Commission. I'm talking about constitutional review commissions. Why should anyone dream that they should stay in office beyond the limit that the Zambians have decided? More than 10 years. What do you want to do beyond 10 years, which you couldn't do in 10 years? If you couldn't do certain things, certainly you will have set the institutional arrangement and the platform for others to continue to achieve what you did not achieve. That's how the relay race works. I trust that my colleagues on the left understand what that means. So thank you to President Edgar Lungu. And you will be okay, sir. Do not worry, you will be okay. We pledge to the people of Zambia that we will foster a better democracy, rule of law, being integral to that, restoring order, respecting human rights, liberties, and freedoms, choices, media. There's a new dawn for you. No one will tear gas you in the exercise of your duties. Isn't that good? Zambians should be at par with any other citizens of a democratic country around the world in the barest minimums that they should enjoy. And no leadership has a right to take away those minimums from its own population. If anything, we should expand those minimums. Watch the space. Check if we are just playing with words. Check that. I'm not talking about lawlessness here. I'm not talking about corruption, because we'll have a zero tolerance to corruption. I'm not talking about it. I'm not talking about it. I'm talking about your rights, your liberties, your freedom to do what is within the laws, your freedom to aspire to be anything you wish to be. I never thought that I would sit and seek the presidency of this country. As I was born in a village, grass thatched house, went to school first 3 years, no shoes. But I got the opportunity. We want to expand these opportunities for all our children to better what HH has become, and more so in the last few days when Zambians decide to accord us with this rare opportunity to save them. Why should that be denied to another child, male or female? Not at all. I want to invite all of you to acknowledge the path we've chosen that we work together with you, you with us, to build a better Zambia for all our people, for all our people. I would like to take this opportunity to thank my running mate. My running mate, Mrs. Mutalena Lumango, all the members of the UPND Alliance, our candidates across the spectrum of this foursome election, councillors, mayors, chairmen, members of parliament. I want to thank all of you. I want to thank all of you for participating in this election, for winning, and those who did not win, for offering yourself for service. Not as masters, but as slaves of our people. All our members, campaign teams, well-wishers who work tirelessly on the front lines, dodging bullets, tear gas, being detained at airports, being denied the right to use airspace. But you endured, you moved on. I want to acknowledge now, I can reveal a bit of a strategic secret here. We had an army of underground volunteers. As we were facing tear gases, as we were not allowed to go to certain jurisdictions, we had an underground movement of volunteers who were working quietly. On top, you could not see them. I knew. I was seeing them every day. And when I saw them, I smiled. And I knew they were doing the damage. Look at the results. Look at the results. Thank you to you all. We would not be here today without your hard work, without your commitment to duty to the people of Zambia. We graciously acknowledge your contributions. No one did more work than the other, not me. We all did what we could, and put together is delivered. We have delivered. Thank you for your dedication to duty. I want to thank my beloved wife. Who has always been on my side. Good times, difficult times. She's been there. I want to encourage young couples, please support each other. Even girlfriend, boyfriend, please support each other. You will see the value of that later in years in your life. Respecting each other, understanding that you are equal. Being husband doesn't make you superior to your wife. Yes. I say it without blinking, because I know what some husbands do to their wives. I also know what some wives do to their husbands, of late. So, my kids, thank you to you, the rest of the family, we love you. We appreciate your enduring love to us. Great source of strength. We give thanks to God the Almighty, without whom this day would have never been possible. Amen. My fellow citizens, we have an enormous task ahead of us to revive our economy and deliver on our expectations. The journey will be tough, challenging, there will be ups and downs, but I'm certain that with hard work and commitment, we will succeed in building a better life for all our citizens. I do believe in that. Finally, let me thank you again, my masters, our masters, the people of Zambia, for the huge mandate you have bestowed upon us to serve you, and we will serve you better. I believe in that. We will not let you down. God bless you all. And God bless the Republic of Zambia. I thank you for listening. Thank you. I'm limited to the subject. The questions must be limited to the subject. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. We now take questions, and the questions should be strictly limited to the subject discussed here. And remember what we agreed earlier on? One question per person, no rider questions. I'll start with one, two, and three.
Okay, my name is
I think she started already. She started already. Thank you. Thank you.
Please state your name and the media organization you're coming from.
We can't hear. Yeah, you can speak seated. I mean,
Excellency, just want congratulations for the resounding victory. And I just want to find out within what period have you set that Zambia should be able to see the economic change and transformation that you promised.
So we'll allow the president to respond, then we'll come back.
Thank you very much to the questions. Shall we just underscore something here? And hopefully going forward, we will take that as the culture. Questions will come from the media. We should not restrict the questions in terms of whether it's aggressive or abusive. I don't mind. As long as you stay within the subject, as per the director of ceremonies, feel free to ask the question you want to ask. The onus is on you to ask a polite question. But I'm saying so that no one should feel restricted. And that culture you will see going forward, to give you the freedom to ask the question you want. Because no question is a no-go area. Thank you. Tikumbi Kaunda, Freedoms. Media, private, public. I actually covered it in a way in my speech, that the fourth estate, and there's another question connected to that, I think number three question, media freedoms, access to information, freedoms, media, private, public. To us, the fourth estate is not just a medium. Because you are media, because you transmit, you are the platform, you are the road for information. You are not just a road for information. You are an important part of the checks and balances. You are an important ears and eyes of society. So let me cover the two questions in one as I answer. We believe in media freedoms. We believe in self-regulation, you heard me, of the media, which means that access to information, media freedoms, regulations that are there, if not sufficient to give you the freedom and self-regulation, they will be enhanced. You have heard me. They will be enhanced. Self-regulation means you have standards, you have professional standards that will allow you to exercise your professionalism, that media houses must be fair. It must cover people equitably, must not project hate message. It is not a platform to commit crimes, but it's an opportunity to deliver news, the content, in a manner that is professional. And you will be able to control each other through self-regulation, true self-regulation, not symbolism, when there are transgressions. Simple, straight. Here's what you want to hear from me. The UPND government is not there to gag the media. The UPND government is not there to shut down prime television. It's not there to do that. Prime, I see your sign. Sorry about what happened to you. It will not happen under our government, under our administration. You will operate as a business. You know your obligations to operate as a business. We're not there to teach you that. You know your obligations. But no political hand will be there to shut down a media house. We are victims of a media shut out on us. We will not appear on ZNBC. And welcome to this house, ZNBC. That reaction from the public underscores our answer to these two questions. That the media must be open to all. The media is not a tool to gag, to demonize. Earlier I talked about hate language that was driven by some of our competitors. I must say it's not just one. Others were saying it, but because they're small, relatively, maybe they were not heard. And you didn't hear us respond. Did you hear me respond?
No.
That is not what the media should exist. Four, don't drive hate language. Be fair. I know that ZNBC operated the way they operated because of political instruction. I want to say to you right away, there will be no political instruction to control your editorial policy under the UPND leadership. Be a true public broadcaster. Cover the opposition. We are confident of our work that we will not mind by using you to shut down the voices of the opposition. Finish. Wamanamdala. Finish. Cover the UPND administration because it's part of your editorial policy. It's part of your agenda. When you cover other political parties, there will be no minister who will visit you to tell you which articles must be covered at the main news time. If you want, start from this press conference. If you don't cover us, it's okay. It's all right. Because the media now has grown, technology has grown. If you don't cover news, you will not generate revenue. You may not pay salaries, and you may shut down. You wouldn't blame us, isn't it? Would you blame us?
No.
If the consumers of your news shun your news, it means you can't get commercial adverts. Then you shut down. We don't want you to shut down. We want to support you. You will see a UPND government that is supportive to businesses. I have a fundamental belief myself as a business person at a young age that and also from my culture, my upbringing, if you want to generate tax revenue, do not kill the micro business, which may be struggling to pay tax. Work with them, help them grow, give them time to pay so they can grow, and eventually you collect more tax, but at a lower rate, fair tax. Then you grow your treasury revenue. You will see that principle applied to other businesses, but media included. I think I've answered that question.
Thank you.
Let me deal with, Matthew. Four things that will revive the economy will do. Matthew, I ask you to be patient. You will see that in our inauguration speech. You will see content in there. You will see the thrust of what we are going to do in government. But to give you a hint, we are seeking government for two portals, two legs. One is to reunite this country. We know the value of unity. Two is to rebuild, reconstruct this economy. 2A, focusing on the economy, growth, investment, opportunity, so that we can do 2B, look after the weak, the sick, the old, the orphans, the retirees, pay them on time. But you can't do 2B without 2A, which is the economy. That's what has been going wrong in this country. To focus on consumption, on luxury, and not to focus on prudence, investment expenditure, to grow the economy, to create jobs and opportunities for our people, to get our people their food. Matthew, that comes from a functioning economy with a clear economic policies, lowering the cost of doing business, Matthew, and being predictable, and therefore being consistent. What you see in the mining sector, changing policies every day, it will not happen under the UPND, because mining is a long-term business. I don't want to get too much into that, Matthew. Be patient. I think the inauguration, all things being equal, ceteris paribus, it will happen in a few days' time, and you'll hear more from us. Before you go, Mwale, Brian, period for economic changes. Brian, it's begun from this speech. Once we restore the rule of law, once we restore order, you heard me say that, it's an ingredient to economic development, bottoming up. You can't invest, no investor, including myself. Let me be candid now, I'll use my own example. In the last 7 years, I took a decision, asked all our boards not to invest any more money because the return was not assured, because the environment was hostile, the cost of doing business was high, and there was lawlessness. Once we restore the rule of law, you will see more investment, you will see more economic activity. We start from there. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you, Excellency. Okay, so we take two international questions, two local questions. Is that okay?
Yep.
So I take two from this side and two from this side.
Shorter questions, please.
Be succinct.
That's not control. It's different from control.
Okay, where else? Okay. Afterwards. You can.
Congratulations, Excellency. My name is Rose from the Protein TV. A big team of the God of Fine TV. And I want to say thank you very much for all the assurance that you have given us. Your speech has said a lot of things, especially one greatest fear that most Zambians had, which was used as a good point during the campaign, which had to do with tribalism. A lot of people thought that we'll be left behind, and we'll be able to change the history. All those things you've tackled. My interest is on what you had said before the elections with regard to the acquisition of Kwacha and inflation, that within 2 hours, once we are initiated, we will see that the inflation is going to rise. So I don't know, since now you are.
Exchange rate, not inflation, two are different. Chivunda, two are different. Inflation.
different from exchange rate.
Yes, no, I didn't say exchange rate. Inflation rate.
You're getting it wrong. The president said the exchange rate will improve.
Kwacha
you
dollar.
Are talking this about is the inflation rate.
Thank you for that guidance. Yes, the exchange rate will increase. So I wanted to know, now that you are the Republican president, how long will that take for us to see that particular change? And my second question.
Let's have some order. Let's have some order, please. You're from Algeria. Okay, yeah. No, I said one.
Just control, just be orderly. Sorry. Thank you.
To your technical administration that was heavily engaged, what is your message to your lenders?
UNDP.
I'm coming down this side. I'll ask Lorenzo. And I've seen Peter. Lorenzo and Peter. Ask.
My name is Lorenzo from Radio Christian Voice. Congratulations, Your Excellency.
Thank you, Lorenzo.
My question has to do with mining. Kindly guide us on your policy on mining. Mining companies have a habit of externalizing profits to the detriment of the Zambian economy and the population. So what would be your policy in trying to arrest that situation and boost productivity in the mining sector? Thank you.
My name is Butizia from Money FM Radio. My question borders on part of your speech. You say that the outgoing president is very safe. And then my question is that in terms of fighting corruption, how are you assuring the Zambians that you will go back and investigate some of what the previous administration did? Because the saying is that when you're leaving office, you make sure that the people that you're taking over from, you don't hurt them, so that they don't hurt you when you actually take over.
It's not an issue. Right, we can deal with that? Can we?
Yes.
All right, thank you very much. I'll be quick in this round, and Chifunda, appreciation of the currency. I wasn't challenging you. I was just trying to make you say what I said. What I said is that the Kwacha will appreciate against the dollar or other currencies, and that in short is exchange rate. So not inflation. Inflation is a bigger subject, is a subject of other things. Yes, there's a component of inflation effect, inflation arising from the exchange rate effect. So let's not go into that lecture because it will confuse people. So I haven't been sworn in. I was categoric because there are things going on that have delayed this message. I'm sure you know. Delays here, there. When we get sworn in, we will deliver a more substantive economic message on how we run the country. But today, we've started by addressing some of the key things. Rule of law. Rule of law. Media, respect for the media, freedoms, human rights, liberties and freedoms. So wait until we put our package of what the investment community, the trading community, local, regional, and external are waiting for. The menu in there, that's the menu which we call, would clearly demonstrate the confidence that we are here to do business, investment is welcome, freedoms will be entrenched. Chifunda, no one wants to put money when you know party thugs can come and take away your property, can come and take away your piece of land illegally. Wait for that. But we've already sounded the initial dose. Just be patient a little bit. Wait for that. Chifunda, thank you very much. Debt is too high, my colleague. Yes, debt is choking development. Message to lenders. Our message to lenders is very simple. Come to the table. The debt we have is unsustainable. Some of it was accrued wrongly, incompetently. But we are decent people. We are a decent team. And luckily, some of them we've engaged them already, well ahead. This is the way we operate. You get used to this. Orderliness, proper planning, execution of the plans, proactivity. We've engaged some of them already. Some we know personally, and they know what we stand for, my dear friend, and they know what to expect. Today is a day I can say to the debt stockholders that you have a new administration that will take debt seriously, that will not sit and wait until it defaults without talking to you. So come to the table. We will discuss the options that are available. We will ensure that there's equity in the treatment of your debt. We will not ask you to come to the table to discuss your debt, and we do an arrangement with you that will allow us the headroom to release resources and apply those resources on the equation side of investment, revenue generation, and not consumption. I hope you are hearing me. I don't want to be technical. I used to be accused of being too technical, but this debt issue is a technical issue. So let me simplify it by saying you have an administration that will get you to the table where you will be respected, your views will be heard, our views will be should be heard by you, and will come to an amicable position, number one. Our intent is clear. The debt is too high. It's unsustainable. Simple, straight. So two, you come to the table. You'll be treated fairly. Three, there will be no cross-subsidization of one debt stockholder to benefit another. That's corruption. It will not happen. Equitas treatment. Number four, once we agree a deal with you to allow us breathing, you know, oxygen to breathe as a country. Otherwise, if we die, as a cattleman, I'll tell you, if you don't feed your cow, don't expect milk the following day. The teats will be dry, and the children will have no milk. So I use that analog. So we will need the cow to continue producing milk. We will need to ensure that that milk is not eaten by the owner of the cow, because there's another stakeholder called the calf. For the calf to grow, it needs a bit of milk also, so that tomorrow it can become the cow and produce more milk. Simple as that. Simple as that. So I think I have answered the question briefly. Christian Voice policy on mining to arrest externalization of resources is not an issue. It's been an issue because there's been no leadership to understand that first and foremost, you need an attractive mining policy to get the investment. Secondly, the investment must grow. Before you look for external investment, you must encourage the existing investments to grow. For existing investments to grow, there must be a return on investment. But there must be also benefits to other stakeholders. Who are they? Workers, mine suppliers, contractors, and contractors. Who else? The treasury. That's your question. So there's a vested interest, there's a mutuality along the way. There hasn't been an administration that understands that simple rule. This administration understands it. And you see that the mines will come to the table, the mines will pay their fair tax, the mines should grow for them to pay their fair tax. We'll also expect the mines to employ more citizens of Zambia. We don't expect a crane driver to be a foreigner. We expect a crane driver in the mine to be a Zambian. And you all know why. You all know why. We expect the board to have Zambians leading the boards. We expect the Zambians to be shareholders in the mining sector. This is the asset God gave us. And this asset must work for the investor. They must work for Zambians. It's a very simple matrix. But where there's no knowledge, it becomes a lopsided issue. It becomes an issue of hatred against another. My friend, we expect you to be a mine owner. When you're a mine owner, we expect you to employ more Zambians. We expect you to pay taxes. We expect you to be able to invite partners that may bring capital to your mine so that the mine grows. Otherwise, you'll be a mine owner in a license form only, and you never get value from the mine. We understand all of that. Buchiza? The externalization issue is not a matter of illegality. It's a matter of illegality, but the legal framework was structured wrongly. We'll address all of those issues. You'll be very happy once we're through. Again, like the debt stockholders, we will engage mine owners. Very clearly. They already know it anyway. Some we've been talking for a long time. Some were surprised that there was no government that would engage them in a manner that the benefits from mining will accrue to citizens, to this country, and to them as well. The government has come that will be able to do that. And you see, very soon, you see mining houses announcing expansion programs. You see mining houses employing more Zambians. That's why the currency will appreciate, my friend. When they know what is coming, and they know we are serious, they will come to the table for mutuality, win-win situation. You'll be happy as Zambians. But if you kill the cow, you kill the mine, whether it's owned by you or someone else, you'll have no copper to take advantage of the best prices at the moment because of bad leadership. Good leadership has arrived. Buchiza, confirmation. Corruption fight. Absolutely misunderstood. We have no fear that the next government will prosecute us. That's why we should not prosecute the outgoing government. No, it's not a quid pro quo, Buchiza. We have a zero tolerance to corruption, zero. But this is not a political vindictive platform, vengeance, retribution. No. The professional bodies, the institutions that deal with that, which is, will deal with that. The policy of the UPND is zero tolerance to corruption, not to corruption. And the two must not be mixed. You can't go out under the UPND government, you're a minister, and you give yourself tenders, you award yourselves tenders. I'm sorry for colleagues who want to be ministers in this cabinet. You give yourself a tender at a high price because there's an issue of future deals. We're not there for that. But the corruption fight must be professional. That's the point I'm making. It must not be used as a weapon to victimize others who are in office, including ordinary citizens. So it will be a professional fight against corruption. One of the things we'll do is to strengthen the institutions, oversight institutions, that are operationally independent, they are funded properly, they do their investigations fairly professionally, and the rest are processes. That's our message. Thank you.
Thank you, Excellency. We have come to the close.
Indeed.
We need to allow the President to rest. There will be many other forums, and you will have opportunity to ask your questions. Just hold on to them, and we'll give you an opportunity to do so. May I ask that we all be upstanding as we sing the national anthem, all the standards of the national anthem. Stand and sing of Zambia.
Joy, unity, lead us in the struggle for the right. We want freedom's fight. Oh, bless by God's good hand.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all of you. And wish you well. Have a good day. Thank you.